Just some words about me. I'm Johannes Agram. I live in Graz, Austria, and I work for SysLab. And I have my own one-man company, Programmatic. And with that, I'm part of the Blue Dynamics Alliance. I'm a foundation member and previous framework team member. And here are some links to social network sites for me, GitHub and Twitter. And the talk, you can get a talk from here to look up for all the stuff. Good. About Vue. I give an overview about Vue. And Vue is actually the name is Vue.js, but not Vue, but I just say Vue throughout the talk. It's just shorter, like everyone is just talking about Vue. And actually it's pronounced like Vue, but I still say Vue, a little bit different. It is a JavaScript front-end framework. You can build web applications with it, and it gives you reactivity. So if data changes on one place, then everywhere where it is used, it's also updated. And that's quite a nice feature, of course. Then it's component-based. You can build components and reuse those throughout the whole project. It has lifecycle hooks, like a component has a method which you can use when it's mounted, then also created and before update and so forth. It also has good documentation, and in all those points it doesn't differ much from Angular and React. It's performance small and extensible. It's probably the easiest framework from compared the easier to learn framework compared to React and Angular. The footprint is also smaller than the other frameworks, and still it has an amazing extensibility. It doesn't limit you in any way most of the time. And Vue can substitute all your views. And that's why I wanted to use it for a current project, which I'm talking about later. So now just a simple example, how a Vue application looks like. You can install the Vue CLI with yarn at Vue CLI or whatever package manager you're using, npm and so. It's recommended to add it to the global store so that you can easily access it and have it everywhere available. I do it a little bit different. I have in my home directory a node modules directory where I install everything and have the node modules.bin path in my path, so it's always reachable. Yeah, however you do it, that's the thing how you can add the Vue CLI, and after you run it, you have this Vue executable available with which you can create a simple boilerplate for the site. And you can also add with the Vue CLI modules and stuff like that. I'm using it always just for bootstrapping the basic templates. And now let's look into the code quickly. This is a very simple Vue application. This is the main entry point, which is opened. You have to import the Vue class and instantiate it here. And you give the Vue class an application entry point, your basic Vue, view or component, however you want to name it, which you want to start with. And this one looks like that. I used to always structure my code with the .vue file extension, where everything, the templates, the JavaScript and the styles are in one place. And you can also split them up so that you have separate templates which end with .html, separate JavaScript which ends with .js file extension, and the CSS, whatever system you're using, SCSS, less, or just plain CSS. And up here, you have to give your main application an identifier or a class which you can use in the main JS. Here, we just use the ID app. And here's an image, and here's a component which is defined in a separate file. And the component is imported with this statement. And for a component, you have to export the component module like that with exports default. So the default says you can import it from somewhere else under any name which you want to. And you name it and you give you reference your component here. And let's look over the component. It looks like that. Similar in structure like the main app view. You always are forced to just have one root element within the template. That's sometimes a bit annoying, but that's the case how it is. Here I print out the message and the name with those double mustache signs. And so it's using a similar variant of the mustache templating framework, and here's an input element, a button which does something with this click prevent stop clear, the click handler. The click handler is defined in the JavaScript part. Here under methods, there's a clear method which is just used when you click the button. Yeah, that's a simple view application. Let's continue with the ecosystem of Vue. So there's UX, which is a data store similar to Flux or Redux in React. It implements the state management pattern and it gives you reactivity, and you can allow your components to talk to each other. You can exchange data via those central data store. Vue is like React, has a one-directional data flow, so you pass data from the parent component to a child component, and if you want to get the data from the child, some data structures from the child component up to the parent component, you have to do it with events, or you just use the state management pattern, the Vuex library, which is much better. In the Vuex library, you have an attribute which is called the state, and the state holds all your data. You can retrieve the data by directly accessing the state or using getters, where you can also apply some methods, some functions on the state. And if you have asynchronous operations, you dispatch them. And if you want to manipulate data, you have to commit them. And this is an example of a store. Here is a state. Here's the state object with the name attribute. And this is this one data attribute we are handling here. Then we have getters, where you can, for example, just uppercase the whole name. An action, which is an asynchronous operation, you get the name, for example, from a web service somewhere. You await until it's finished, and then you commit the response like that. And here, the last thing is a mutation. This is there all methods are combined which are used to manipulate the data in the store. You always have to manipulate the data via mutations. Otherwise, the Vuex pattern won't work. So, to the router, It's also a like Vue X library which is managed by Vue itself. If you want to have different URLs pointing to different views, you have to use a router, and that's what Vue router is providing. And a simple root module looks like that. You import the router from Vue router and import your views. Here are two views imported, the home view and the about view. The views are totally similar to components. They are just complete sites, more or less. A component is most of the time something, a little part of the website, and the view is just a bigger one. But that's a technically, they are totally the same, just a different name. And here we have two routes defined. One, the home route, if you just go to the website without any other path, it gives you the home component back. And if you add a slash about, then you get to the about page. And if you use the history mode, then all those root changes are tracked in the window history object. And you can use your back button on the browser to navigate back. Yeah. And Vueify, another library, which is also very useful. It's a UI library and implements the material design pattern language, and it's quite complete. It's like Bootstrap, more or less. It just gives you a different kind of components, like alerts and buttons, banners, much stuff which you always probably need. It's just, you also can theme it and so, and it's just useful. Then there's Nuxt, which is a Vue framework. And Nuxt gives you server-side rendering out of the box. You don't have to do much to get it working. You can use it for static site generation, and it comes with much predefined configuration, best practice view stuff, and it gives you automatic code splitting and automatic routing, and still you can fine-tune and configure it. This is the website. The project, which I'm showing you later, does not use Nuxt, but it's recommended to look into that. And now some important references. You just need to know about the JavaScript ECMAScript 6 changes, and yeah, it's really fun to work with JavaScript nowadays, especially with all the new features which are, and the tooling. So this is a, just get yourself updated if you already haven't done so. Then the Vue guide is a must read. It's really, really simple and small. It's just more or less the essential section here, which you are through that section in some few hours. And then, of course, the components section is also very interesting. But with the first essential section, you are ready to develop Vue applications. Good. The RP documentation is also very helpful. Then the Vue X guide for the state management pattern, and this is even much simpler than much shorter the documentation, and still, if you read this through, you are mostly a Vue X expert. And the router guide also very helpful, and so on. Yeah. Good. Now about the project which I was developing. Empower Help is an organization which helps victims of defamation cases to get their rights through and so. So they help them defending themselves, empower themselves, and it's. There's an offline space where people can come and get consulted, and there's also an online space, yes, it's already here. An online space which should help with going through these cases. And a case is described first, then it's analyzed, then strategies are developed, and actions defined, and finally everything is evaluated, and you can jump back to different stages in this process from any other stage. And the roles in this project are: there are clients which search for help, then there are the coordinators which coordinate the whole thing, and external experts are invited to help with such cases. There's some more info at this website, but it's very, very. There's not much info actually, because it's somehow sensitive, so it's not everything is available in the public, and because it's a very sensitive topic. And an online platform should help in those cases, in developing those cases. When I was invited into this project, and when we first did the environment analysis, and we found some tools, especially in the field of refugee coordination, online tools for organizations, but none fit actually our use case totally. And we were using Plone, because Plone just comes out of the box with a very good security system, very good workflow system, which we are using for those different stages, evaluation and action definition and so on. And we have hierarchical content here. We wanted to build something like a forum where you can just post messages and answer to other messages. And with Plone, that's also easily possible. I thought of instance behaviors using them, but we actually didn't. And also, of course, we are experienced in Plone, so that was a simple choice to use it. And why Vue? The first prototype was actually done with page templates and tiles, I had to decide to use this project as a playground for learning something new, and I had already some experience with Vue, and so I used it. It was quite a challenge to get everything done, and but a lot of work is in this project, and but I think it's, the direction is quite good. It's not finished yet, totally, but I like how it's working. Yeah. Now to the implementation. I give you a code walkthrough. I show you the folder structure, how the router is built, a bit of the store components, and let's see what else. Here is the Vue front end available for you to look into. And the Plone backend under this repository. Good. Sorry. First, I show you the application, how it's working. It's, as I said before, it's not finished yet. Especially the design has to be adapted to be more like we did in our initial sketches. But here's a login button where you can log in. Your username, I'm just logging in as admin, so I have all the rights here. So, what's happening? Yeah. You can add a new case on this page. I make a test case, write some test text, and format that with bold maybe. Then I define the rights here. So I define a client which can, which is able to go into this case and look for the for all the information. Then there's a coordinator and some experts. And those people have now access to this case. And in this case, yeah, that doesn't look very, very nice actually. In this case, you can write a comment, for example. And get it in here. And if you answer to that one, it's displayed in this thread structure. And then you can, for example, from here directly create an analysis. Get it displayed here, and you can change to this analysis and work from there on. So. And here are some overviews over those things. Yeah. Still some stuff to be finished, but mostly the design. Okay, let's go to the code structure. This is the root directory of the source tree, more or less. Up here, there are some configurations, package JSON, and so. But in the source folder, we have the assets, which where you can put some images and CSS files and whatever. Here, a components directory, directory where all the components live in. Some directives like a can directive, which is used for permission checking. The elements define some form elements for the input fields. Here are some plugins. The data store. Some views. And the app view, main, JS, and so. Let's look into the router, because there was already a quite interesting talk by Eric Pdo today, talking about traversal, which is fundamental to Plone. And I also implemented this pattern here with this application. This root path matches any path actually, and I give it the name view factory, and I handle this thing in the view factory. The view factory is responsible for. Using another component which matches the type of the current object. So if you have, for example, a path with slash cases, slash test, for example, and you query the REST API with that, you get back a JSON structure with the add type attribute, which defines the type of that object. Let's look into the view, the view factory. So this is basically the template. What it does is more or less immediately calling another component. And the, this is a generic component, actually. The type of the component is defined with those colon is attribute. And the component JavaScript object here, variable here, gives back the real component object. All the possible components which I want to be able to handle in this application are imported here. It's a cases view and a contribution view and a default view, a fallback, which I actually not really use in this project. They are also defined here in this components object, and there's this computed object where methods are defined which are just called once. So if you and then cached. Only if some attributes change in the value which are used in those computed methods, then it's recomputed, and this gives you a quite nice caching mechanism. You cannot pass any options in here. And I have a context available, which is retrieved in another component actually, but this context is just in the store, and I have it available in the current context gives me a type, and this type, for example, a type which I use is named dexterity type is named contribution, and this type is then just given to this statement here, and then, for example, the contribution view is called. The contribution view looks like that. You have again other components which are referenced here, workspaces, workspace tabs, and a section, and then a thread component is opened. The thread component is responsible for displaying the content structure in this thread view. Let's look into there, the thread view. This is the thread component. It displays a contribution. This line is not so important here. And then it calls again itself. As long as there are items available in the current context. The REST API gives us an items attribute which lists all the items within this possible folder, if it's a folder. And if it's not a folder, then there are no items defined, of course. Yes, so what else can we look at? Maybe the edit view, the edit component. This defines a form, and whenever this form is submitted, the save action handler is called. And here are some input fields, a text line, and a text editor, and the autocomplete field. And down here, we have the save handler. It's an asynchronous operation. The save handler dispatches an action in the store. There's the context module in the store, which defines a patch operation, and I give it I pass it the context. Okay. And when it's done, for example, a content is created. I can upload some files if there are some files available, which is quite nice. So you can actually upload something in a totally newly created content. Yeah. And let's look into the store. This is the context module in the store, which is called in the contribution edit component, which I showed before. Here is an asynchronous operation which loads the context. And down here is the patch operation. If a context is available, then it's with JSON parse and JSON stringify, it's more or less copied, and then it's cleaned up. So any information which I don't want to submit to the server, like the ID, is just stripped out of the model. And then I use Axios as a as an Ajax library and call the patch operation there, submit the path and the model, and that's then the plon rest API is called, and the object is then patched there. With post, I can create objects, and this is basically the whole context store file. It's actually a bit big, but that does all the magic for storing any object, retrieving and creating, and so. Here are some mutations. So if I want to change something, I have to call the mutations and not directly edit those. So when the asynchronous operation here is finished in the patch store up there, in the patch method, then the commit method is called to manipulate the attributes in the store. Okay, so you might have a look at this this application at the GitHub URL which I showed you before, and let's continue with the presentation. So what's the future about this development? I could imagine to create a Vue Plon SDK out of that. I had that in mind. That's maybe something which could be done in the future. Then, of course, tests have to be written if it's really open source and deployed like that. And then Vue.js 3 is coming soonish, and it would be, of course, good to upgrade also that Vue SDK stuff to that. But currently, I don't have very clear plans of following this path. It's also depending on interest also and projects needing that. So what's the situation between React and Volto or Vue? Volto is a complete Plon front end which aims to implement all the Plon functionality. And what I created here is definitely not the case. It's just a simple web application using Plon as a backend. Yes, there's nothing similar in Vue. So Vue is definitely nice to be used on for applications on top of Plon, but still be aware if you use something for a project like that, it's not like you are really getting fast everything done. There's a lot to learn, and it probably takes you, if you do the first application with Vue, it probably takes you longer than the classic backend rendered approach. And in the end, it's a matter of taste and experience what to use. Volto, Vue, React, Angular, whatever. There are many options available, and so choose one based on your experience and use case. And if you need something which is full blown, then probably Volto is the thing to use. Okay, that's more or less all. Thank you.